Thank you very much. We planned a kind of hopefully very interactive session. So first of all, I would like to hear something about you. I think there are proper amount of people here, so we're going to do a round. Think about one thing that you think is the most important thing in education. One word. And then tell your background, if you're a student, teacher, something, if it's related to education or whatever. So one thing which is important in education and your background. Can you start there?
Claro.
Soy estudiante, estoy terminando cuarto. Entonces estoy estoy empezando las prácticas ahora del grado y para mí la palabra sería alumno.
I'm also a student. I'm in fourth grade. No? Y for me the most important word is enjoy.
The word is liberty. And the same of this.
I am a teacher, and the word will be creativity or passion.
Un ex alumno de aquí de la universidad y para mí una de las palabras es formación integral.
Hello, my name is Jorge. I'm also a teacher. For me, the word individualization, maybe. Thank you.
Hola, buenos días. Mi nombre es Rafa y también soy antiguo alumno de esta universidad y creo que la palabra más importante para definir la educación es progreso.
Hola, yo soy Rafa. Estudio tercero de CAFIL aquí en la universidad y la palabra que más define la educación para mí es libertad también, como ha dicho.
Hola, soy José. Estoy estudiando tercero de CAFIL y la palabra para mí sería productividad, por decirlo de alguna forma.
Yo soy Sergio y yo creo que lo importante es inculcar valores y virtudes.
Hola, buenos días. Yo soy Gonzalo, soy estudiante de tercero y yo para mí lo definiría como disfrutar aprendiendo.
I'm Juan, I'm professor for commercial law here in this university, and I think that the most important thing is the interest of the students in the matter, that they think that they're learning interesting things.
Hi, I'm a teacher, I'm preparing the PhD, and I think the most important is to accompaniment to the student.
Hi, hello, my name is Beatriz. I work in the communication department, and I think the word for me of education must be personal development.
Hola, mi nombre es Carlos, tercero CAFIL, y la palabra que definiría sería disfrutar.
Hola, mi nombre es Dante, soy alumno de tercero y creo que la palabra más importante sería educar, como la misma palabra se define.
Hola, me llamo Marta Hernández, estudio segundo de CAFIL y estoy de acuerdo con lo que ha dicho Beatriz, creo que es desarrollo personal.
Buenas, soy Víctor, soy profesor de Magisterio de Educación Física y estoy cursando tercero de CAFIL. Y lo más importante es el desarrollo personal y la creatividad de uno mismo.
Hola, mi nombre es Flor, trabajo en el Gabinete de Orientación Educativa de aquí de la universidad. For me, the word is happiness.
Hola, mi nombre es Ana, trabajo en el Departamento de Comunicación de la universidad y para mí la palabra más importante es motivación.
Yo soy Rocío, soy periodista y antigua alumna de la universidad y para mí la palabra que la define es libertad y personalización en los contenidos.
Hello, my name is Rodrigo and I will say teachers.
Hi, my name is Lola on behalf of Escuela Newspaper, I am a reporter. For me I think the most important word is citizens.
Hola, soy Laura, soy periodista, estudié en la Complutense y un gran profesor siempre decía que lo más importante era desaprender, eliminar todas las teorías y todos los mitos que nos habían enseñado para crear los nuestros propios. Así que desaprendizaje.
Buenas, yo soy Víctor, también soy periodista y mi concepto clave sería pensamiento crítico. Creo que es un...
Okay, thank you very much. I tried to come up with some unifying thoughts about those things that you brought up. I would divide them basically into two plus one. Basically, most of them are like being present at this moment, like happiness, joy, or something like that. And many of them are to the future, like productivity, motivation to do something or things like that. So, and the unlearning thing comes a bit from the past. So I think it's important to remember that education is always happening in the present. So if there's so many studies about how important it is to actually get joy from the learning in order for it to be meaningful. So it's not about the future only, it has to be about the present also. I was hoping kind of to organize this thing so that there would be groups, but maybe we can do that when we start the group work in the end. So we're going to organize this all this. Session is going to be so that there's 10 topics on these tables. I'm going to do a short introduction to each of them, and then you have, or you can vote which ones you prefer. Everyone has 4 votes, and you have pens, and you can go and mark 4 votes. You can put 4 votes on one, or you can divide them separately. And if you want to cheat, you can cheat and put as many things as you like. But I prefer that you try to stick to the 4. With the most votes, we choose the topics. 4 topics we're going to have time for dealing with. So, the first one is the Finnish education system. So I've been a teacher for about 20 years in Finnish education system, in the primary, in the kindergarten, in the secondary high school, and also in adult education. So I have kind of a broad spectrum of how the education system in Finland is formed. The second topic is about democratic education. How many of you are familiar with democratic education? Just raise your hand. No one? Good. So basically, democratic education is a form of education where everyone in the community is part of the decision making. So there's not usually just one principal or someone who decides about things. all things are discussed together and decided upon together. So even the four-year-old student has the same power as the teacher. And this, of course, leads to many variety, a lot of variety in the democratic schools. So there's not one type of democratic schools. They are all different based on what the students and the teachers decide in that school. So there are schools, for example, where you have regular lessons. Usually all the lessons are optional because students don't usually like to be forced to go somewhere. So, but you might have a set of lessons and you might usually go to them. And then there are schools which are more open. There might not be any lessons at all unless somebody requests for them. So it might be, there might be no classrooms at all, just a campus where you can go wherever you want to go and do whatever you want to do in the limits of the rules decided together. So that's the kind of idea of democratic education. And basically the reason behind it is that democratic education believes that children learn best when they have a voice in what they do and in what kind of community they are. And also about the learning. When children can decide what they learn, they are self-motivated and they get the joy out of the learning. So those are a couple of things. So that's one thing I can talk about. And then changing the education system, that's one thing I'm kind of enthusiastic about. When I found about alternative education, alternative ways of creating schools or teaching children or adults or whatever, I became totally kind of, it blew my mind, basically. I found out that actually it's possible to be in a school without nobody forcing you to do anything. And still you learn basically the same or even more things. And it's meaningful, it's fun, and so on. So I started to figure out ways how to change the education into more like that way. My first thing was, because the teacher education in Finland, as all over the world, is still quite traditional. And I heard from many teachers that actually the teacher education doesn't really prepare you to be a good teacher. So I applied to the university and got in, and after half a year of studying in the education, it was very clear that this kind of education doesn't prepare me to be a good teacher. So I rebelled. In one lecture I went to the front of the lecture and told that I'm not going to participate in any testing anymore because it doesn't make any sense to me. And that led to a small group of students, and we went on in each course requesting for alternative ways of testing or proving our knowledge. And that eventually led to a totally new teacher education line. So in Helsinki University, there's now two separate teacher education lines. One, the traditional model, and one which starts with a group of about 10 students who decide themselves what they want to study, how they want to study. It's an autonomous group, nobody telling them what to do. And they have 4 years' time to educate themselves to be good teachers. That's another way of learning to become a teacher in Finland. So I'm enthusiastic about that. And then there's the democratic classroom. There are examples of how to create democratic systems inside one classroom, because how many of you are teachers or becoming teachers? So quite a few. So I can talk about different models, how you can involve or get the students involved in the classroom decision making, how you can shape the classroom into more convenient and so on. That's one thing I have some experience with. The new curriculum in Finland, 2016, that's one topic. In Finland, we just released the new curriculum, which comes into effect in 2016. And it has things like all the students are supposed to be involved in the decision making of the school in some way. And also they should be part of creating the local school curriculum. So students, and both of course the teachers and parents, should be involved in all levels of decision making. Yet it's still traditional curriculum in many ways. It has the traditional subjects, but you can also combine and integrate subjects if you want. And it gives a huge amount of freedom to individual teachers to apply the curriculum. So I'm interested in, I haven't read the whole curriculum yet, and it's not in English online yet. But I can give you some ideas about it in more detail. Then there's transforming the Spanish education system. Of course, I'm not master or author of that topic, but I can give you some ideas what you could do here in order to transform the local system. I've been here for 2 days now, and we did we visited 4 different kinds of schools, very different schools here. So I got some kind of picture what you're dealing with here. There's the personalized learning, the Knowledge Constructors project. I started my own school in 2005, a democratic school called Phoenix School. And for 3 years, we ran it as a, we started in a public library. So my students came there every day and we talked and I helped them learn the things that they needed to learn. On the third year, we had to give up the system that we were using for the studies, because it was an adult education system and the Ministry of Finland told that we cannot use it anymore because our students were children. So we have to come up with a new idea how to run the school. And I came up with some ideas, but they didn't really work that well. So in the end of the third year, I decided to have a break. So we ended the school for 2 years. And then came up with the idea that if this new system that I was coming up with, basically it's a system of putting the curriculum into questions and tasks. So for example, in biology, we have more than 400 questions and tasks for the students. But they are free to choose whichever question they want to do whenever. And that system is now online. All the questions for all the subjects, for all the grades are online. So the student can kind of build their own path of learning using those questions. And that's the project we call Knowledge Constructors. So that's why I'm actually here. We are considering with the people here how to integrate that project into Spanish schools. Then changing the society through education, that's an interesting topic to me, because I think In that topic, I'm going to talk more about the society. Like, we live in a society which we call democratic, but actually it's quite far from being democratic. Like, it's more like a corporate federation. We vote for people to decide for us. We don't have the power to decide. Some people have. And we don't have the money to decide. Some people have. About less than 1% of people actually have the power. So it's even further from democracy than the ancient Athens democracy was in some ways. So it's no wonder why we don't have democratic education, because it's the society is not really democratic. But if we change the education into more democratic, it might make our societies also more democratic. That's an idea. Then 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Yeah, that's the last. Well-being in schools. That's also one very interesting topic to me. For 15 years, I've been involved in an emotional healing program where we learn to unlearn the things that we've learned and learn, for example, to express our emotions and communicate, contact people better, and so on. So that's one very interesting thing, how we can implement things like that in schools, or like meditation or whatever kind of things. We can help the children to connect with their bodies and heal their mind. So those are the 10 topics. Now it's your time to vote. 4 votes or more if you want to cheat. Do we have the pens somewhere there? So grab a pen and mark 4 topics, or however you want to divide your points of votes. So all the topics are here. Just make a mark which one you want to decide. Everyone can just go. And pens are here. All right. We got the 4 topics. We have the Finnish education system, transforming the Spanish education system, and changing the society through education and transforming. What was the one there? Changing the education, yeah, right. How to change this education, right? All right. So, I would like to do this in a way, like, put it here. So go in, take a pair, pick someone, and you have 2 minutes time to come up with one question for every one of you, each one of you, and write your own question down. We have papers here. And we can start with the Finnish education system. And yeah, I would like to have one question from every one of you. And when you finished, give the paper to Jose or Javier, and they will pick the questions for me, because I don't obviously have time enough to answer everyone, every question. But I hope they can kind of pick up the most essential ones. So, yep. What's one question for everyone? Yeah, so two questions for there. So, 2 minutes time. Go ahead. Yeah, I think we need to start. Yeah. Okay, I think we need to start. Okay, if someone hasn't finished yet, take your time and pass when you're finished. We're going to start with the question. This was in English here. So everyone has their headsets. How the Finnish education system is organized, and what kind of levels do we have? So I'm going to basically show you the picture of the Finnish education system. So basically we start with the kindergarten in Finland is quite separate from the schools. Like in here, you have the kindergarten inside the schools usually. But in Finland, it's usually not necessarily, no. Okay. I've just been to some schools, it's the age 3 to 6 is inside the school. Yeah. But in Finland, until age 6, it's not usually inside school, but they have a separate place for that. And usually it's how it's organized is usually also much different from school. So it's mostly based on playing and free time. So it's not some teacher telling the children what to do. They have a lot of freedom in the kindergarten in Finland. And at age 7, we start the basic education. And it's a 9-year education. But one big separation is also that in Finland, you're not required to go to school. So you are just required to learn the things that the curriculum tells you to learn. But if you are, for example, very smart and you want to do it faster, you can do it in 6 years or 3 years or 1 year and be done with it. And you don't have to go to school at all. And of course, homeschooling is allowed in Finland. So you can study at home if you want to. But it's not very common. So the compulsory education is basically, usually you go at age 7, go to school, and in 9 years, you're done with it. And there's a possibility for a 10th grade. This is kind of extra year if you want to improve your grades and have one more year to just take your time and so on. And then you can decide whether to go to vocational studies or like here's the general upper secondary school, like the high school, which is in Spain, which is the 2 more years which people usually go after the compulsory education. And then you can choose if you want to continue studying to go to polytechnics or the universities. And in all levels of the education, everything is free. You are not supposed to pay anything. Well usually in even universities, for example, there's a small annual fee, like 100 euros or 50 euros or something, which is like nothing. But in basic education, it's all free, even for private schools. There was just a news article in one of the biggest newspapers about one private school asking money from parents and some people complaining because they are not supposed to ask money. All the money, of course they can ask money, but it has to be voluntary. But yeah, it didn't seem voluntary to some parents, so they are kind of sued about it. So that's a big difference. And pretty much same goes with the everything else here. So you can just apply for the secondary or higher level of education. And according to your grades, and the entrance exam sometimes you get in or not. Just recent years, there was a law which requires the government to offer at least some kind of secondary education for everyone. So even if you don't get in to the vocational school or polytechnic or somewhere, the government has to offer you something. So you're not left with nothing. And in addition to the basic education, the being free, also the meals, the lunch is free. So all the schools offer a free lunch during the school day. That's kind of it's not very usual in the world, but it seems to be an important thing. So, next question. The next question is, what is the weakness of Finnish education system? I would go with the thing that because Finland has been very homogeneous society, we've been only Finnish people in Finland, and we got very few immigrants. And now that we've gotten more immigrants, we're kind of puzzled about what we're going to do with them, because that's a new thing to us. And in many schools, they have lots of problems with immigrant children. That's of course, it's pretty similar in every country, but well, in Finland it's a new thing and we are struggling with it. Also, because all the schools are public schools, basically. There are private schools, but they are still public. Like everybody can attend them and there's no entrance kind of qualification. Everybody can go to any school. There are some specialized schools which can do some entrance exams, but basically everybody's allowed to go to anywhere. And that creates a kind of thing that all the schools are pretty much the same. There's not huge variety of schools because, yeah, even though there are private schools, they still are pretty much the same. And all the schools have to follow the national curriculum. You cannot create your own curriculum. Yeah, actually all the schools or all the local cities have to create their own curriculum based on the national one, but it's still pretty much the same. So I guess the lack of variety is the biggest kind of threat or thing that's suffering in Finland. Okay, let's take next question one more.
This is what's the best Finland education system and why did you get such a good result in PISA?
Okay, yeah. So yeah, there's a lot of discussion about why do we have such high scores in PISA tests and what how do we reach that? I'm very skeptical about this. First of all, one professor told me that the PISA test actually doesn't measure school knowledge. It measures common knowledge. So what everybody should know, basically. And it's basically just shows that the Finnish society is quite knowledgeable in general. And it doesn't necessarily have to do much with the education system. Of course, we built the education system early on to be quite equal and inclusive, so that everybody has had the access to proper education. So we have a great foundation from many years. And that's kind of the key of building the general knowledge of the population. But if you compare Finnish education today to some other countries like Sweden, Denmark, Germany, and South Korea or somewhere, there's not huge differences. It's more like the society. And for example, I think one of the biggest reasons why Finland scores so high is the small number of immigrants. Because the language, everybody knows the language, it's easy to answer the questions, understand the questions. When in some countries, the immigrant people who participate in the test don't necessarily even understand the question. So that's probably one big reason also. There are really nice things about Finnish education system, but it's not necessarily the main reason. All right, I guess we need to change the topic, or do we have some special? Okay.
How are the school classrooms and students and teachers?
Okay, yeah. So in more detail, what are the numbers in schools, like how many students in each classroom and what's the ratio of teachers and students? It's not set in the law at the moment. So the local government can decide how many students per teacher. But it's the average is around maybe 20 in primary schools and maybe 25 in the upper school, like the middle school. I call it middle school. Officially, actually, we don't divide the basic education into primary and middle school anymore, or primary and secondary. Officially, it's all one school. Like in here, I understood that there's a law which prohibits primary and secondary students to be in the same building, if I understood right. But in Finland, it's one school. For example, in some schools from 7th to 9th grade, like ages 13 to 15, the school has decided to divide the classrooms. So the average number of students for each teacher is 10 to 15, which probably makes a big difference. So, yeah. Okay. Yeah, right, yeah. Okay. We take next topic is the transformation, or how to transform the system of education in Spain. Some of you have already made some questions about it. But do you think there's enough questions about it, or should we go
two or three?
Okay, yeah. So I'm going to start with this, kind of introducing the topic by comparing Finnish education system and Spanish education system. And then we're going to have another 2 minutes before you can discuss and come up with new questions. So I've already talked about some of the differences, like the private sector in Spain is, of course, much bigger than in Finland. There was a period of about 10 years during which time no private school got a new permission. So there were no new private schools during 10 years. And just in recent years, new private schools have come up. And usually the private schools are like language-oriented or country-oriented, like Spanish, French, German, or so on schools, which concentrate on one language. Or they are specialized in one pedagogical method, like Montessori or, well, there are actually very few Montessori schools, but there are more Steiner or Waldorf schools. How many of you know what kind of school is a Waldorf or Steiner school? So I'm gonna, or Montessori schools is just more common. Yeah. So basically, the idea of Waldorf school is not hugely different from the mainstream, but for example, they don't use textbooks in general. They, the students make their own textbooks, and they use a lot of art, dancing, and things like that, which kind of make it more holistic kind of education. And for Montessori, it's a kind of, Maria Montessori from Italy was the first professor, university professor, woman, university professor who came up with the idea of how to solve problems with problem children, basically. She was given a group of students or children who were thought to have no future at all. And she started experimenting with different kinds of methods. And in the end, the children that were in her care scored higher than the average students in the population. And those methods are used in the Montessori schools. So let's take 2 minutes, and you can maybe you can come up with one question for each pair. That makes more sense, I guess. Okay, 2 minutes. Let's see. So. If you can make questions about how to transform the Spanish education system now, that would be the best option, because that's the topic I want to try to deal with. If you have questions about the previous topics, you can write them down, and if we have time, we can deal with them. It would be actually nice if you have time to write the questions down in some web page and do something about them. It would be really interesting. But yeah, we start with the So yeah, I'll start with the two very good questions. The first one is how can teachers transform the education system? Well, of course, teachers are in the key role of changing the education, because I think also in Spain, teachers have a lot of autonomy in how to actually do the teaching and how to form the classrooms. I think the first key is to be enthusiastic about education and learning. And if you love learning yourself, that's probably the key to transform that to your students. For example, here, I think, because my job is not to learn much new things here right now, but my job is to kind of bring my ideas and make them into your action. That's the challenge I have, and that's the challenge that the teachers face. How to transform the knowledge that you have into the action of your students. And if you can show that you're enthusiastic about learning in general, of course it transforms also to the students. Many times the one key thing also is that because we are all people, we are all equal people. If you can face the child, even a small child, as a complete person, it might make a huge difference. It only takes one person who treats you as an equal or as a whole person, that which can transform your whole life. And that's a big thing you can do. So never underestimate your power. And never take yourself too seriously either. Because it's an important thing, hugely important thing that you're doing. But it's not your action which counts. It's how you transform the ideas in and make them the students' actions. So you are more like a facilitator. I don't know if that's the right word, but someone who encourages and brightens up the future of the students. So that's one thing. I'll take another one, because that's a hugely interesting question. Another question was, because if you change the education or how you do the classroom work inside the school, if you make it very different from the traditional, of course you are getting many questions from the parents and maybe the principal and every other teacher. So how to convince them in your new methods or new ideas? That's a really good question. First, I would like to keep on with this old the thing that I said before, that as long as you keep your enthusiasm up high, it will influence the people around you. If you can show them that you are actually enjoying your work more with your new ideas, it will show the other teachers that maybe something else is possible. It's not going to be easy. It's not going to be something that you don't need to work on, because in addition to changing these ideas, and because it's that there are not many models that you can like just pick up and put into practice, but you because it's always about human connection and how to actually get your students involved in these new ideas. It's always experimentation. There's always a risk of failure. So you need to be brave and try new things. And you need to keep your spirits high in order to convince other teachers. And you need to know the background, why the change is important, and what's the science behind it, for example, so you can convince the parents, and so on. Convincing parents is a key in changing the basic education, because if the parents disagree, it will transfer the disagreement to the child. And it will be very difficult for the child to learn in the new methods if his or her parents are pressuring or telling some bad things about the teacher. So connecting with the parents is very, very important. Yeah. Next one.
Giving to them power in the method.
Okay, cool. The first question is, what are the risks of giving power to the students in a democratic education? That's a question that is very often asked. I would start rather than asking another question. What are the risks of not giving power to the child? Like, everybody of us probably know that we didn't have much power in our education, and when we got out of the education, we were kind of, we didn't really know what to do with our power when we suddenly had this, we became adults and suddenly just everything's up to us. Nobody's telling us what to do. But if in a democratic education, we give the power to the students, of course, we don't just send them away and let them be on their own. We support them and we make limits, we make rules together with the children so that they are safe but still have the freedom, as much freedom as possible in the safe environment, so that they will gradually learn how to use their freedom. A good example is in a democratic school, when a new student comes from a traditional school into a democratic school, it takes about 1 year for the student to actually start being able to handle their freedom. And we all know that it took us a long time until we actually realized that we are free to do whatever we want to do. Some of us, most of us, didn't realize it yet. it's a huge thing to realize that you are actually in the charge of your own life, because all our childhood we were told that you are not supposed to decide yourself, and there's someone else who knows better than you what is good for you. So I would ask rather, what is the risk of not giving the power to the child? Next one. Okay, let's see. Do you think democratic education uses an underlying conception of human being which considers it as essentially good and neglects the evil dimensions of us humans? That's a very good question, yeah. So, I think the majority of democratic schools and teachers start with the conception of people being good in nature. And and the trust becomes from the idea that when you trust someone, they start showing, they start being trustworthy. The good and bad idea, it's a very interesting concept. My understanding is that whenever someone does something bad to someone else, it is because they have been treated badly before. So, and there's actually a lot of science to back this idea up. It doesn't seem that we are inherently evil. The reason, for example, for this is that we are naturally social. I just watched a video about research about pain, social pain, and it actually triggers the same area in our brain as physical pain. So if we are hurt by someone mentally, the effect is same as being physically hurt. So, for babies, for example, when a baby gets separated from the mother, the pain that the baby feels is the same as if she was hurt physically. And the same goes with the mother. So we are very, very strongly connected socially. And we don't want to hurt anybody else because we know how it feels. But if we are hurt, and as we all are hurt by many things, we end up hurting others. And it's not our intention. It's just kind of a mechanism in us where we try to get attention to try to heal our hurts. I have some examples from children that I've been working with. I sometimes brag about how many children I've worked with. Like there's more than 3,000 young people that I've been working in education and youth work. And so I think I have some kind of experience. And there's one example where a young boy about 10 years old was very aggressive. He kept hitting others and took some scissors and was trying to hit someone. So basically what I did was just stop him, not tell him that he's bad, he's doing wrong or whatever, just stop him so that he's not able to hurt anyone. So it's a safe situation. I took the scissors away. And he started, of course, trembling and hitting me and being very aggressive towards me, which is better than being aggressive to other students. And I was just holding him and keeping telling him that everything is fine, you are safe here, and I'm here for you. And suddenly he started crying. And it's a beautiful process, really, because after he was crying for maybe 5 minutes or so, he just light up. You could see that he's back there, like he's alive again, and he's happy. All it took was someone to be there for him and for a moment keeping him safe, and then it's all good again. So this is just an example of how we usually think about aggressive behavior being bad behavior, while it's just a request for someone to grab you and hold you for a moment. Yeah.
How can you plan a curriculum if every student can design their own?
Right. Yeah. That's a very good question. Like about how can you create a curriculum if actually everybody is free to do whatever they want to do? So actually, in many democratic schools, you don't have a curriculum. Everybody is free to pursue whatever interest they have and learn the things that they want to learn. Of course, in many countries, it's compulsory to study certain things, like in Spain, for example, in Finland also. So one solution, there's one school in Germany, and they solved it so that for the first 6 years of the basic education from age 6 to 12 or so, the child is completely free to do whatever he or she wants to do. And in the last 3 years of the compulsory education, they start studying the compulsory subjects. And in the end, you cannot tell the difference between a regular student who has started from the 7 up or 6 up from the one who started at 12. So, and this one who started from 12, he's probably much happier, because he has the freedom and the confidence that you build up, being able to decide for yourself and so on. So that's one way of doing it. My solution, creating this new kind of online education system, was to put all the curriculum online so that the student is free to pick whatever things they want to learn on whenever. We have about 70 students in our online school in Finland, and they usually spend 1 or 2 hours a day for the studies. And that's what it takes to learn the same things as you learn in a public school for 6 to 8 hours maybe per day. It just shows you how much more work or how much time is kind of wasted in the school environment. Yeah, this is a very good one. So what can you do to make the a regular school more democratic? There's one very simple solution. You can just ask the students what they want to do or how they want to do things. Then it's a democratic school. In practice, you can, of course, do also many other things. But in a classroom, that's very simple. What that leads to, you have to be very open-minded. And actually, if you start asking the children what they want to do, and then tell them, no, we cannot really do that, and no, we cannot really do that, I don't want to do that, and so on. Of course, the children will feel again powerless, and it's more hard next time you ask them. So in the beginning, you need to be open-minded, but it might be a good idea to tell the students what are the limits, what things we can actually decide upon. If you have a curriculum that you have to follow, you can tell them that we need to study these and these things, but we can decide together how we're going to study them. You can give them some ideas, some examples. We could do some group work. We could go outside, visit some places. We could just study the textbook, or we can look for internet for some ideas. So, because many times students don't really know what are the options that they can choose from. So your role is giving them the ideas, what is actually possible, and also letting them actually decide. And that many times creates really, really interesting discussions. Like you can go from one very simple topic to very deep discussions of many different things. And that's the beauty of democratic education, that it's about all about conversation and all about communication. And you can start from one point and end somewhere totally different. So it's all about how open you can be to the process. So that's inside classroom. If you go to the school level, of course it's more difficult and more challenging because you have to get all the teachers involved in somehow. Of course, simple solutions can be to just elect a student body, which can then decide or participate, for example, in teachers' meetings or some other meetings and give some ideas to the teachers what to do, for example, with the schoolyard or so on. But once again, you need to be very clear on what they can decide. You could give them a certain amount of money that they can spend however they want. But if you really want to be a democratic school, you should not pick certain students from the student body, but involve every student in the decision making. Because it's not really democratic for this one student. It's not democratic for me if I cannot decide about Finnish things, things in Finland. I'm excluded from the decision making of Finnish politics if I cannot participate in the decision making. And same goes with the school. So if you want to take every student to the decision making, you have to create some kind of methods in that there. Simple method could be like deciding in your teachers' meeting, for example, what are the things that we want to ask from the students. And then each teacher goes to their classroom and talks with the students and comes up maybe with some suggestions, and they need to do the teachers meeting and gather them and maybe bring them back to the students, and if there's something that you can exactly decide, and you could give one vote to each student, for example. Yeah. So one more question, I think, then we're gonna do a small group work. So it's about the radicalism in Europe. The youth employment, young people joining ISIS, voting radical parties, and what is my opinion on the role of the role play, the education, which role the education plays on it, I think. So I think at the moment education plays a huge role in the extremist movements, or the, how they encourage young people to participate, because inside the schools students usually have no voice, and these radicalist movements give the possibility for them to have a voice. They take the young person seriously. They might abuse them. They might give them some totally insane missions or tasks to do, but it gives them a voice. And I think that's one crucial thing. So as long as we have schools which don't give any voice to students, the students will try to find the voice somewhere else. And those places may not be so healthy. So once again, we can ask, what is the risk of not giving the voice to the students? Yeah. So I guess we are done with my talking. And so if you can maybe turn the tables around so that you can form proper groups. And yeah, maybe three to six people for one group. And the task for the group is to discuss about how can you take these ideas into practice. And for each group, try to come up with, if you can come up with three ideas, that's brilliant. But try to come up at least with one idea. So yeah, turn around the table so you can form proper groups, or you can just turn around if it's easier. So we're gonna basically do so that every group can present your ideas. So start there.
Bueno, suponiendo que cogiéramos como ideal aquí en España el modelo finlandés, al igual que ahora en España se ha puesto años atrás tan de moda la enseñanza del inglés mediante profesores nativos, trayéndoles aquí con nosotros y siendo ellos los que propiamente enseñaban las clases, posiblemente podría ser buena idea, ¿no?, el traer un, pues bueno, profesores que nos pudieran enseñar, pero sin caer a lo mejor en el error de tener luego que depender de ellos para que tuvieran que dar las clases, es decir, que fuésemos a corto plazo, ¿no?, nosotros mismos los que pudiéramos poder dar esas clases, ¿no? O sea, es decir, que no tuviéramos que depender de ellos y al final tener en nosotros un problema y convertir esa posibilidad de enseñar en un hándicap para luego el propio profesor, dándonos cuenta que no tenemos esa capacidad, ¿no?, de poder dar las clases. Y bueno, no sé si se puede, ¿no?, pero como pregunta, al escucharte he notado como que percibes como que al final todo, como Finlandia es como un grupo muy cerrado, ¿no?, una sociedad muy cerrada, y no sé si eso luego va a ser como un problema, el decir, el ponerlo en práctica aquí, porque el volumen, lógicamente, de clase de los alumnos no tiene nada que ver al vuestro, y no es lo mismo a lo mejor un debate entre 10, 15 alumnos que 25, 30, y bueno, no sé si se convertiría eso en un problema fuera de lo que es Finlandia. Gracias.
Maybe I just answer that. It's a good question. I just answer it. The problem. There are many research papers about the number of students in a classroom and how it affects the results of the learning, and it's quite surprising actually that the number of the students doesn't matter so much. It actually matters almost not at all. So, for example, it's all about the communication, and even if it's a big lecture with hundreds of students, you can make it an active learning experience. You can divide, like I'm trying to do here, like divide the students into small groups, give them tasks, and for example, the learning platform that I'm using, it's not about the number of students, it's about how to create the personal or small group path of learning, I think.
Hemos centrado el debate en esos mínimos entre la libertad que se da a los niños a la hora de votar y unos objetivos mínimos que quieres conseguir al final de curso. Entonces, lo que habíamos dicho a la hora de ponerlo en práctica es establecer al principio del curso esos objetivos que quieres que todos los niños sepan y en función de, por un lado, las habilidades de todos esos niños y sus preferencias, conseguir que cada uno a su ritmo aprenda, pero aprenda al final unas cosas que has establecido. Es lo que hemos dicho.
Yeah, right. Yeah. Yeah, it's good then.
Bueno, nos ha costado un poco plasmar una pregunta, o sea, una respuesta, porque hemos empezado a debatir y nuestras ideas iban encaminadas a cómo poder sensibilizar en España a la población sobre los beneficios que puede tener la educación alternativa a la tradicional que existe en España. Un poco las ideas era, creemos que hay un poco de desconocimiento sobre este tipo de educación, entonces creemos que es muy importante sensibilizar pues a través de dar a conocer qué se está haciendo en otros colegios, cómo puede ser a través de un documental en el que se enseñe cómo los niños aprenden y aprenden mucho sin necesidad de estar sentados 8 horas mirando una pizarra. Y después creemos que es muy importante que las universidades también se forme a los profesores de una forma democrática, de una forma abierta, que se les den herramientas para el futuro y a los padres, por último, ¿no? A través de las famosas escuelas de padres que existen en los colegios, poderles pues esto, ¿no? Enseñar o hacer partícipes en esta forma de enseñanza. Creemos que es muy complicado, pero bueno, también creemos que es posible, que se están haciendo cosas, ¿no? ¿Queréis decir algo? Gracias.
Okay, we are pretty much done with the time. So, it's really good to have you, everyone here, and I'm really hoping that you got some new ideas about this, and can bring those ideas into practice. And changing education is one of the hardest things because it's such a tradition, and people it has to do with children, and parents are very protective, and they don't want to risk about getting new ideas which wouldn't possibly work. So, but there's so much research, so much, so many people have already done new things, and when you go to a democratic school and you see the joy on the children's faces and how they held themselves so much freely, it just makes it very clear that that's the way where I want to go. So I hope you can change the future with me and have a wonderful rest of the day.